episode of the Lit RPG Podcast. I am Ramon Mejia. Every week, I bring you the latest Lit RPG news, reviews, and of course, author interviews. And this is episode number 34 of the podcast. Before we get our show again, we always want to thank our great supporters on Patreon. Jay Taylor is the highlight of this week. He has upped his Patreon pledge to $10 a month. That's more than doubling his original Patreon pledge. So Jay Taylor, I just want to say thank you very much. And if anyone else wants to support the podcast, by that means you can do so at patreon.com/geekbytespodcast. We're supporting this podcast and of course that other one I do, Geekbytes Podcast. Okay, on to new releases and reviews. We have this week I'll be reviewing Eden's Gate, The Reborn, a Lit RPG adventure. Additionally, I'll be reviewing three short stories in the Gamers universe, Operation Cat's Paw, Operation Snowblind, and Operations Pirates vs. Drones. Additionally, I'll be reviewing Potty Mouth. And finally, More Than a Game, Feral Book Run. This is that new Lit RPG from the Russian side of the world. It's actually been translated in English, and this is the first book in, I think, 11 or 12 book series. So there we go. We have a bunch of stuff to review this week. We are going to begin the show, of course, though, with Lit RPG news. And in Lit RPG news, we're going to be with some great deals for you, the viewer and listener at home. We're going to be with Luke Chmielenko, author of Ascend Online. He's putting his best-selling novel, Ascend Online, on sale for 99 cents. So if you haven't read it, go do yourself a huge favor and go buy it. If I've already read it on Kindle Unlimited, I'm going to buy it anyways. I love it that much. So thank you, Luke Chmielenko, for making this a no-brainer buy. If 99 cents is not a good enough deal for you, the author of the Omegaverse series, G.R. Cooper, has actually put his first book in that series up for sale for free. That's right, folks, free, F-R-E-E, the price that you don't really pay. It's a good series. I actually like it. The first three books in that series are all sci-fi lit RPG set in like a sci-fi game world. Book four, however, jumps into a fantasy world. Is it the same universe, same main character? It does transition into a fantasy world, though. So it's a really interesting series. I enjoy both sides of it, sci-fi and fantasy. So I enjoy it. Go get it for free, though. Okay, also in Lit RPG news, we have Alaron Kong, author of the Chaos Seed series. He's put some Lit RPG merchandise up for sale at his website at litrpg.com/store. You can get some cool merch, t-shirts, hoodies, phone case, a bunch of cool things on there, so you can grab your Lit RPG merchandise there. Additionally, Alaron Kong is actually organizing a Lit RPG meetup. It's going to be in Atlanta, Georgia, at the Joy State Game Bar on March the 11th, 2017, from 2 p.m. to 5 p.m. I'm assuming that's Eastern Standard Time. And he's going to host it. So if you live in the Atlanta area, anywhere near there, I highly suggest that you go find out where it is and sign up for it. You can web the link in the show notes, but it's going to be under meetup.com, Atlanta Geeks Nerds Meetup. The rest of the things in the show notes. You can also do a search for a Lit RPG meetup from Alaron Kong and it'll pop up somewhere, but it'll be in the show notes. Okay, a couple announcements. Spawn Campers is out as an audiobook. That's the second book in the Crucible Shard series, I believe. I reviewed it a few weeks ago, so I won't go over what I thought about it, but I'm always up for new audiobooks. Sometimes the audiobook version is even better than the written version sometimes, but I know we have a lot of audiobook listeners. Additionally, Soulstone Awakening is also out on audiobook. I enjoyed that series, even with the loosey-goosey game mechanics that appear sometimes, so I'd encourage you to go listen to that one. Give it a try and see if you want to download it for Audible. Okay, speaking of more audiobooks, Alaron Kong, Chaos Seed series author, is actually going to re-release his entire series out as audiobook. The first book is going to come out on March. He had an original narrator do it a while ago. Apparently, he wasn't quite satisfied with the product, end product, and he's having another narrator do the entire series. So it's a much bigger project. And the author is going to be Nick Podeh, P-O-E-D-H. Apparently, he's the author for some other big named fantasy series. But again, their first book is going to, and the Chaos series, come out in March. And every single month thereafter, apparently, is a new audiobook, book 2, 3, 4, etc., until they catch up with the regular novels. So look forward to listening to those. Okay, now we have, unfortunately, a few delays and some little RPGs on our schedule. James Hunter wrote on Facebook this week that his next Lit RPG novel, Viridian Gate Online Crimson Alliance, long titles, is going to be delayed. The editors apparently have it for a while, and they haven't given it back yet. It's being pushed from February the 17th release date to Snow Later, from the author, to the February the 24th. So it's only about a week-ish pushback. Hopefully it'll come out a little bit sooner, but, you know, it's something beyond his control. He wants to make sure it's a good product, so leave it with the editors as long as possible to make sure it comes out well. So there you go. Additionally, For the Guild, which is the book 3 in the Amarillia series, has been pushed back to a February 28th release date. It's still an amazing schedule. That author has put out book 1 in January, book 2 just a couple weeks ago, and book 3 later this month. So that's 3 books in only like a month and a half, basically. So that's still an amazing schedule. And he still plans to release a new book every single month. And these are hefty books, by the way. They're not small 100-page novellas or anything. So it is reasonable to expect that they take a little longer. So I'm okay with waiting an extra week or so. Also, Jeffrey Falcon Logue, author of the Slime Dungeon Chronicles, has said that his third book in his series is finished. Done, complete, and it should be available for purchase in the next couple weeks. So there you go. That's a positive, folks. And Dungeon Madness, the second book in the Divine Dungeon series by Dakota Craft, is out now. We're not going to be reviewing on this particular podcast just because I haven't had enough time to read it. It came out the day before that I'm recording, basically. So it'll be on the podcast next week, not this week, because this week was full and I have a limited amount of time. Sorry. But I've read a little bit of it so far, and I'm enjoying what I'm reading, so I can tell you that much. But the full review will come next week. Okay, now in the upcoming Lit RPG, we have Viridian Gate Online, Crimson Alliance, coming out February the 24th. For the Guild, book 3 in the Amarillia series, February the 28th. We have Spitznauts, a permadeath Lit RPG, Lit FPS series, out on February the 28th as well. And then we have The Crystal Sphere, out on March the 10th, 2017. We have Awaken Online, Precipice, that's the second book in that series, out on March 31st. And then somewhere in March, Delvers LLC, book 2, is supposed to come out. It's going to be called Obligations Incurred. So there we go. That's the stuff that's upcoming. Okay, on to new releases and reviews. Okay, in new releases and reviews, I reviewed the Lit RPG that has come out recently on Amazon for people to purchase. I'm going to begin with something that came out last week, but I had to push it into this week's schedule because things get busy. Eden's Gate, The Reborn, a Lit RPG adventure written by Edward Brody. This is a 317-page novel, $3.99. It is available on Kindle Unlimited. Now, there are two basic storylines within this particular novel. One is the one where the main character explores a new world he's trapped in, goes on quests, gets equipment, learns some magic. That's part of one. The second storyline in this is an exploration of how non-gamers would feel if suddenly 5 million people were killed and their minds were trapped inside of a virtuality, full immersion video game. And how people feel when even more people voluntarily do the same to get into that game world, knowing that it'll kill them. Now, the United States and other world governments actually feel threatened, and they try to shut down the game. And this is part of the plot of the storyline in this particular series. It's very interesting. I really like the story. It felt familiar, yet fresh. The opening plot line kind of feels a little bit like a Sword Art Online. The premise is set up similarly, where the players of Eden's Gates are trapped in the game by a mad developer. Only in this case, the players' bodies die, so there's no hope of returning to Earth yet, I hope. Maybe, might get a weird plot twist in book 2 or something. I don't know. But I really enjoyed the realistic fear-based reaction of general society to this event. I always thought it was kind of weird in Sword Art Online how nobody really seemed to freak out in the real world that this happened to their people. Or at least that wasn't explored in the light novels or the animated series version of it. And that is definitely explored here. Like, people freak the heck out. And they want to shut it down because they don't understand this weird VR gaming immersion stuff. Which is honestly justifiable considering that 5 million people just were murdered and their brains were uploaded to a video game, to a MMO. Now, the main character, Gunner, is super likable. I find myself rooting for him from the very beginning of the story of Eden's Gate. I also really like that there are realistic consequences for the decisions that the main character makes as he starts his new life in Eden's Gate. If he makes poor decisions, selfish ones, there are bad consequences. When he makes good decisions, good things happen, of course. But he can never replace the lost reputation or the consequences of his bad decisions, no matter how much he tries. They're just, you know, done. So there's no takebacks. This is a very flexible world where reputation actually matters. Now the game mechanics are pretty standard. There's nothing like super new and amazing. You have health, mana, stamina, damage percentages, all that good stuff. There are no set classes, but an open skill system where you can basically learn anything you spend your time on, whether it's magic and swordplay or, you know, whatever it's going to be, which I like. I like flexible mechanics like that. They allow for more interesting and well-developed play styles, potentially. Crafting has only really been explored in this particular story with the ability to upgrade weapons with the rune stones, so I'm hoping to see more crafting stuff, maybe in book two, or, you know, if the author decides not to explore that, that's fine too. This is still a fun, action-y adventure story. And I kind of like the magic system that was set up. I wanted to learn all the different types of spells in the game, which is always a good sign for me that this is a good lit RPG when I start planning out my own characters in this game world. So it's always good, it's a good plus for me. It's a solid story, well written, engaging, good action, good adventure. I can't wait till the next book comes out. I give it a solid 8 out of 10. So that's my recommendation. Okay, next we have The Gamer's Universe. Now this is actually going to be 3 short stories. The Gamer's Universe is created by S.R. Witt as a part of a PhD level writing program called Phoenix Prime. He collaborates with J.L. Hendricks, who is also in the program, on a couple of the short stories set in this universe. While this story series is not directly advertised as lit RPG, part of the description of each book states, if you're a fan of lit RPG, gritty science fiction, adventure, cyberpunk, or multiplayer games, this is the series you've been waiting for, which is why I'm going to review it. Because they kind of imply that it's a lit RPG. Okay, now each of the 3 stories I'll be talking about has its own separate novel. They're each priced at 99 cents, and they're available on Kindle Unlimited, so all the pluses there. Each short story is about 40 to 60 pages, or about 10,000 to 12,000 words, and I'll be reviewing each entry as an individual story, and then I'll give my overall opinion of them as a lit RPG at the very end. Okay, so we're going to begin with Operation Cat's Paw. This is one is written by S.R. Witt. Now, a group of mercenaries take the job to retrieve some valuable tech from a space station. If they succeed, they get a bunch of points to use to pay bills and get upgrades. But it turns out that tech is attached to a person, specifically a vulnerable young girl in a glass tube. This is a cool infiltration story. It's very sci-fi. It's set in the far-flung future where there are space stations, spaceships, augmented people, like cybernetic people with an augmented reality system, which I'll talk about a little bit later. And it's a cool infiltration story. Lots of great action. Can't complain about it at all. It's short. I mean, 42 pages, but it was a very engaging story. So I liked it. Next story is going to be Operation Snowblind. This is the second book in the series. It is written by S.R. Witt and J.L. Hendricks. Okay, one of the characters from the last story is the lead character in this story, Zots. He takes the lead in this particular story. He's a former mining slave, and he was rescued by the space crew he is now with. He leads the team in an operation to sabotage a mining colony while he tries to preserve the lives of the mining slaves he discovers there. So it's very much a backstory story with this particular character. And it's really well done within a very short amount of words, I have to say that. It's not as action-y as the previous story, as Operation Cat's Paw, but it is a little more hacker-ish. I liked the backstory for Zot. It's a very interesting way to describe him, his motivations, his character. I enjoyed it. There's a cool use of drones. There's a cool use of artificial intelligence to exploit the tech of the mining facility. It's a good sci-fi. I liked it. Okay, on to the last story in this trilogy. Operation Pirates vs. Drones. Gotta love that title. Again, this is a collaboration between J.L. Hendricks and S.R. Witt, although J.L. Hendricks takes point on this particular story. Now, in this story, another character from the very first book and second book, Throd, who's a half-war machine member of the Metal Rats, books passage on a pirate ship to complete a mission involving taking on the cybernetic scourge of the galaxy. And it's fun. This one's action-y, but it's also very interesting. There are some really solid twists in the space pirate story that I enjoyed. It's also told from the perspective of the pirate captain of the ship, and it was really nice to see a non-game player operator's point of view in this universe, to see how other people view that particular feature of this universe. And it was kind of cool. I like the villains. It was, again, action-oriented, but it's also very army-y, piratey, space pirate stuff, which is kind of cool. And I don't personally like water pirates, but space pirates for me are a big draw. I like them. So that's cool. Of the three, this is definitely my favorite. And that's Operations Pirates versus Drones. I enjoy them all. Okay, now my opinion of the three short stories. On all of them, there's action, there's cool technology, there are moral choices throughout them, and there's always backstory. However, this is definitely sci-fi, and it's not lit RPG. Now, in this universe, there's a corporation that uses augmented reality to hire operators to complete missions. They're kind of like mercenaries, but the system they use for their missions is gamified. There are points instead of hard cash. There are main objectives, bonus side objectives for each particular mission. And the activities of the operators are also broadcast to undisclosed subscribers for entertainment value. So it's kind of a gamified jobs board in a way. And that's how I kind of see it. It's not so much a game mechanic system as it is an augmented reality, you know, job board kind of thing that happens there, which is not the same thing as a game system for that little RPG uses. Now, to kind of show you what I mean, in Lit RPG, there are two qualifiers that make it Lit RPG. One, there are the story is set in a game world, or there are game mechanics in that world that are obviously stated. And in this particular case, that is trying to be done through this augmented reality system. There are two points to the game mechanics in this storyline. One is the points that teams get for completing their missions. And the second is a reference to leveling for team members that allows them to get new pieces of software or artificial components. And that's kind of it. Those are the two main points that are supposed to make up the game mechanics in this world. And I don't really see that they're actually game mechanics. They're more along the lines of just things that are put in there to make it feel a little more gamified. And that's not the same thing, to me, anyways. I kind of explain this in this way. If I can replace the words points with credits and leveling with upgrades, and that destroys any sense of a game system, it probably wasn't a game system in the first place. And to be fair, this isn't really a drawback. It's just a statement of my observations in reading it. The authors don't directly claim that this is a Lit RPG story. They kind of infer it in that statement I read earlier, that this is if you're a fan of Lit RPG and gritty science fiction, etc., this is the series you've been waiting for. You know, this is, and it just isn't Lit RPG for me. It's still a really good series. I liked the characters for the Metal Rats crew. They kind of give me a real Firefly vibe, which is really good. And I like the stories. It's just, they're not Lit RPG, which is kind of a disappointment. So that's kind of it. I mean, that's kind of my opinion. I definitely recommend them as sci-fi stories, just not as little RPG stories. So there you go. Okay, on to the next review. Potty Mouth. This is a short story in the Caverns and Creatures universe, written by Robert Bevan. It is 26 pages for $2.99, and thankfully it is available on Kindle Unlimited because that price point is a little high. Now, if you've never read the Critical Fail series by Robert Bevan, that's the same universe here. And if you have read it, then you're already kind of familiar with the special type of potty humor that makes this series beloved. Between full book releases, the author also writes short stories, about 25 to 30 pages each, with the same characters from those larger novels in the Critical Fair series. Now, Potty Mouth is without a doubt the only one of these stories that I would classify as political satire. This is kind of a departure from all the other short stories, all the main stories from this author. It actually has an amazing number of pee jokes in it for 26 pages. So there is going to be a political bender. If that's not your kind of thing, then don't pick it up. If you're okay with that kind of storyline, you might find it entertaining. You might not. I can't tell you how to feel about it, but it is political satire. Robert Bevan has also stated that all the profits earned from this story, Potty Mouth, will be donated to the ACLU. So even if you don't like the political bend of the short stories, the profits go to a good cause. So that's always a plus on my half. So I picked it up. I actually paid the full, you know, bit for it. Additionally, all four volumes of the Critical Fail series are actually on sale right now for 99 cents for the entire four books. So that's a great deal. Even if you don't pick this one up, the stories are funny in the main series, and they're really cheap right now. So go Robert Bevan. Okay, one more to go, folks. One more. More Than a Game, Faerûl Book 1. Now, this is 322 pages, $6.95. It is unfortunately not available on Kindle Unlimited. The author, Andrei Vasilyev, has written about 11 or 12 books in the Faerûl series in Russian, and this is the first one that has been translated into English. It's a rather expensive process to translate it, somewhere in the neighborhood $4,000 or $5,000 US, more expensive in Russian apparently, to get this kind of translation done. And so I purchased it just to encourage this kind of translation. And they're hoping that American English readers are going to enjoy this lit RPG stories. It says in the description that it was voted best book of the year by Russian readers at some point in the past. But again, this is kind of an older series. And you can kind of tell from some of the game descriptions that it is a bit older than the things we're reading now. Having said that, of course, I got an early release from the translators so I can review it as quickly as possible. But again, I paid full price for the book, the big almost $7 price tag when it was released. Okay, now on to the review, short version. It's okay, and it gets better. The beginning of the story, I kind of had an issue with, well, not issues with. It just wasn't that super entertaining for me, and I'll tell you why in a second. Okay, the basic premise of the story is this. Harrington is a reporter that gets assigned to write a series of articles on the latest fully immersion VR game, Faerûl. That's it. That's why he jumps into the game, because he's a reporter and he's writing articles. It's not complicated. Now, again, the first 30% of the book, this particular character, Harrington, he kind of just plays as a VR tourist. And this is kind of the author's way of explaining the basic game mechanics of this world. And there's an exploration of player versus player fighting, player versus environment fighting, and also guilds in the story. And for me, that wasn't super interesting. Other people might like it more. But personally, my particular, and this may go back to like my personal gaming style preferences, I'm not into guilds. I'm not really into player versus player fighting. I like player versus player action when I'm playing MMOs and such, but guilds just aren't that interesting to me. That's a personal preference, which is why I probably felt that the first 30% of it just wasn't super entertaining. Like, it wasn't bad. It wasn't poorly written. It just wasn't super engaging for me personally. But after that point, once the main character, Harrington Hagen, as a warrior, goes off and explores the world, I had a really good time. The quest from that point on are entertaining. They're interesting. They felt very unique up to a certain point. And I like them a lot. He actually goes on a number of different interesting storylines. Like, he fights under the landlords, witches, witchers, Vilas. There are a bunch of monster characters. And it was more engaging to me on that particular. As a solo character exploring the world, I liked that kind of storyline a little bit better as a personal preference. Now, there is a real-world storyline in the book. It just doesn't do anything. This isn't a complicated story where he's trying to save the world from conquering by artificial intelligence. And he's a reporter, so he has to occasionally jump out of the game and write the stories he's being paid to write. Like, the biggest things he has to deal with in the world are a jealous girlfriend and a demanding editor, you know. But there's a real world aspect to it. Now, there is a potential storyline in here where, as a game character, he discovers a really rare quest, and then the guilds in the game are starting to look for him to gain access to that quest, and it even spills into the real life. Now, that doesn't really pan out in the story anywhere in this particular book. I think it'll pan out in later on in the series as he, you know, eventually goes to explore that rare quest. But for now, again, nothing in the real world really has an effect in the game world. Okay, just one small point. This story felt really familiar at some point. Like, I think I've read it somewhere before. About at the 40% level in this book, I kept getting the nagging feeling that I've read it somewhere. For, like, every single, like, the encounters and the quest, I kept, like, predicting what the next one was going to be. And it felt really weird. So if you've read this story before somewhere, let me know, because I couldn't find it anywhere. And it's kind of bugging me. So you can send me that information at feedback@geekbytespodcast.com. or at litrpgpodcast@gmail.com if you've read this somewhere before, because it's just bugging the heck out of me. Okay, that's it. There you go. I enjoyed it. It was good. Give it a quick 7 out of 10. If it wasn't for the slower beginning and the power leveling of the character by those guilds at the very beginning, it would get a better score. It's just that first 30% wasn't super engaging to me. So 7 out of 10, which is still a good score. 5 is average. 10 is perfect. 7 is in the middle there somewhere. It's a good story. And I'm looking forward to reading the rest of the series. So that's it. We're done. Finito. A lot of stories this week, guys. And if you enjoy the podcast, folks, you remember you can find all the ways to support us at litrpgpodcast.com/support. Even if it's just, you know, sharing the link to the podcast on your social media, Twitter, Facebook, whatever, or liking us on Facebook and Twitter at litrpgpodcast. You know, that's a great start. I mean, that's a great way to support us as well. Let other people find us. They can enjoy this podcast too. Thank you, everyone. But that's it for me today. Thanks for hanging out. Thanks for listening to me talk about LitRPG and the things that I love about it. Until we can meet again, folks, remember to go read some LitRPG. Bye.